I'm honored to be here to deliver the Bhogilal Leherchand Memorial Lecture. I think the values which he stood for need to be reiterated again and again in today's society. I'm also humbled to be here among people who are all givers to various causes. Personally, I'm happy to be here because the Forum of Free Enterprise was very dear to my father-in-law, the late Professor B.R. Shenoy, who was an eminent economist. So today's title, Giving is Receiving, My Journey. I worked in the field of skilling underprivileged youth from villages, youth from tribal villages for over a decade before skilling was fashionable, before the government spoke about demographic dividend. And the work was always linking the youth to jobs after skilling them. And 6 years later, I decided that I should set up my own organization, Youth for Jobs. I was very clear about three things. One, I did not want to repeat the work I'd done in the past. Two, I wanted to continue skilling youth because if you catch them at 20, you influence the next at least 50 years of their lives. And third, more importantly, I wanted to do work which embodied compassion. I was very influenced by Mahatma Gandhi's values and his values of compassion. I don't know how many of you know the story of why Gandhiji chose Sabarmati as his ashram. Maybe some of you know, but to those who don't, let me tell you the story once again, which I really love. Yes, the water was there, the river, but he told the other people, listen, if I'm going to continue this satyagraha journey again and again, the British will have to put me into the jail. So let me not trouble them to take me very far away. The Sabarmati jail is nearby. And then he also said, when I die, my friends will have to cart my body. So let this also not be too far away. The cremation ground is nearby. Such compassion, I told myself. And that is how we zero down on disability. To skill youth who are from vulnerable, neglected section of society, to skill them and then to put them into jobs. There's a very close connection between disability and poverty. Most of the people who are disabled are poor because they don't have livelihoods. And when I saw statistics, it simply amazed me. 80% of the world's population of disabled is in developing countries like India. So I knew that if I created an impact in India, I would actually influence the globe. And that's what's happening today. So, 6 years back, we decided and we set up our first training center. We decided to work with youth with disabilities from villages because we said, after all, India is 69% villages. Easier said than done. We went to the villages. Where were the youth with disabilities? Yes, there were youth, but we couldn't find those youth. And when we found them, the parents looked at us as if we were crazy. They told us, what? Jobs for these useless children of ours? Not possible. And in fact, when we began the work, many of them would actually come to check out if we are for real. So the youth had incredibly low self-esteem and confidence levels. Disability is one word, but there are various kinds of disabilities. So we had to customize the curriculum for the different disabilities. And the special educators are all trained by the government. The best of them go abroad, the worst of them don't understand markets. And when we thought companies was not a problem, companies came to us in our first batch, mainly because they had heard Madam is doing some new kind of work. But when they came, they actually told me, their jaws dropped and they asked me, Madam, can you give me some youth who look like you and me? And then I realized that our journey with companies is going to be a long and difficult one. The government, it believes in giving subsidies and doles, and during elections, they are so large. For example, in the government of Tamil Nadu, they give them land, they give them TV, they give them computers. So much so, both the parents and the youth has no incentive to work. I keep telling governments again and again, but of course, no one listens. So these were the challenge which we were grappling against. And I really, you know, was saying, gosh, have we bitten off more than we can chew? So to energize my own batteries, I traveled across the country and I decided I'll speak to persons with disability who were successful entrepreneurs working in the theater and to businessmen who had combined business with disability and compassion. This resulted in the book, and I would like to give these books to the people on the dais, called You Can. It was released at the Jaipur Literary Festival. I was lucky, before me was Karan Johar, so there was a huge audience to listen to why he's gay. They all sat back to listen to me. So my book became one of the top 20 bestsellers at Jaipur. And a Hindi translation came out last month. It was released, so it'll have a grassroots audience. The book is in a second edition, even though my publisher, Bloomsbury, clearly told me that disability is unfashionable and will not sell, but that's another story. So what it does is it has stories like Arvind. Arvind was born like you and me without a disability. When he was 16, on a picnic, he fell on a slope and the doctors told him that he would never walk again because he had broken his spine. But he turned around a loss-making 1 crore company to a successful 365 crore company. Not that he didn't have challenges. When the hurly-burly North Indian workers saw this new young leader on a wheelchair, they immediately went on strike. The security guards in the airport will ask him to stand up, even though he could not. Once he noticed that the food packets on his flights were marked Bombay. He was actually going to Delhi, so they'd put him on the wrong flight. And when he came back injured, his swimming membership was taken away by his prestigious club. He told me laughingly, as if my disability is a disease. As I was walking away, Arvind told me, he said, you know, Meera, will you help me set up a foundation for my older workers? Because, you know, these people all have talent. They just need to be retooled. And then I realized the success of Arvind's joy was the fact that he's not absorbed with his own challenges, but he's constantly looking on how can he improve the life of others. The other half of the book talks about people and chairmen who combined business with compassion, like Nirin Chaudhary. He used to be the former president of Yum, which is the franchise of KFC. So when Nirin was posted to India, he was very clear that as he extends his business, he'll combine it with a cause. The cause he chose was speech and hearing impaired. So I don't know how many of you have gone to KFCs, okay? When you go there, you'll find in the most prestigious KFC, we all have to adjust to the world of those who cannot speak and hear, because all the people who serve you are speech and hearing impaired. Nirin told me that my customer matrix is the best in these stores. My visitors book overflow. So why should I not extend this? So listening to all these stories energized my own batteries. The message for me was, if they can, I can. And I told my readers, therefore, so can you. So many of these earlier challenges now we have overcome. So this is how Youth for Jobs today looks like. Advocacy is the heart of our work. We've touched about 275,000 households, villages, schools, colleges, society, with the message that there's ability in disability. We work with rural youth. We work with educated youth. We work with companies. We work with, in schools, because the rot of the education system begins in schools. So we work in a girls' blind school. We do a lot of work with companies, because otherwise, how will our youth get hired? We also do studies. In fact, we've just completed our study of inclusion in the banking sector, which will get released here in Bombay. And what it does is it gives a way forward to the people in the banking sector in this particular study on how do you begin your journey. And we nurture startups. And the first startup is my own startup. It's called Not Just Art, the world's first portal of disability art. When you look at it, you'll be simply stunned by the kind of talent which artists with disabilities have. When I traveled across the country, parents used to meet me, bringing their youth, asking whether he can get a job through the organization. And there were many youth whom I actually could not, because the market was not willing to accept them. But they would bring me little pieces of paper with piece of arts. And I said, you know, let me connect them to some portal or something. I looked, researched, and I found there was none. So I said, okay, let me create one. So I created it. I'm hoping in 5 years we'll mainstream disability arts so that we won't be needed. 2 days back, I spoke at UNESCO. They had invited me to talk about not just art. And Eric, the director, was so excited after he saw the work. So he said, UNESCO will be your first partner. So they've come on board, and I think this work will go with their support. We are 6 years young in this space, but the largest in the country. We have 25 centers, and you can see they're spread right from Guwahati in Assam to Trichy, right down. And now these centers have really become very demand-driven. For example, the governor of Nagaland has invited us to come there. The commissioner from Haryana called me last week to come there. The government of Kerala has invited us. So it's very, very demand-driven, and we go whenever we are invited. We work with about 550 companies, out of which 200 are the first-time hirers of youth with disabilities. Happy to tell you that 30% are girls, and we work very, very hard at it. In India, if you're a girl, if you're poor, if you're disabled, you have big burdens on your shoulders. Parents hide you thinking it's a curse. They don't let you come out of the house because they're worried that the siblings won't get married. And we want these girls to get a job and stand on their own feet. Our first global center has been set up in Mauritius. So our whole model is scalable and replicable with the help of the bankers there. And we're constantly asked to come and do workshops globally. But you know, our heart of not just me, but my whole team lies in India. There's so much to do in India. It's like a non-stop. The problem is so deep. So we're still thinking, you know, how do we take this work globally since there's so much interest in it? And of course, we won awards, the highest government award, the highest international award at the UN headquarters. But that really, for us, gives us courage that we are in the right direction. So the flagship of our work is skilling youth with disabilities from unreached villages, from tier two town. We spent 1 year of ours just building this template for scale, so that it can be taken to any part of the country with a little bit of customization. So we are in the metros, we are in Nagpur, we are in Coimbatore, we are in Ahmednagar, we can take it anywhere. We are in Mauritius. It's the same template which you customize, and that's why we spent a lot of time on the template. What it does, it gives the youth what they do not have. We teach them communication English. When you hear them singing, you actually won't even understand what they sing, but they sing with such pride because they know English, and that gives them confidence. They know computers, typing. We tell them how to adjust to the new work environment, how to save money, mobility. These are the kind of skills we give them. Then we put them in on-the-job training, and companies come and interview them and take them for entry-level jobs. These are our speech and hearing kids. It's in sign language. We begin with yoga. We teach them these skills because we think the first job is very difficult. So if you don't learn to relax, you know, it's an important skill. For the visually impaired, there's a lot of technology which needs to be taught. There's a software called JAWS, which is a speaking software. So we teach them mobility, we teach them technology, we orient them for government exams. We teach them control of the body, because I used to wonder why, you know, if it's a girl with disability, the mother comes and sits with that girl. And then I realized that she's protecting her daughter from the sharks outside. So there's a lot which we need to do in the field of visual ability, but we're making small breakthroughs in that space also. I always thought that if a youth with disability is educated, he does not need organizations like Youth for Jobs. But however, I just wanted to test my idea, so I went to a most upmarket college in Chennai, where my friend was volunteering to help with placements. And I asked her, what happens, Sarla, to your students with disabilities, the girls? She said, oh, everyone gets placed. But I pushed and I said, can you introduce me to three girls? And when I spoke to the three girls, the story was the same. They were bright, they were good. They did their online entrances perfectly, but when the interview happened, they said, no jobs for you. I, on the other hand, was so excited after seeing all our youth with no English, no computers. You were with these girls, you know, who knew computers, who knew English. So I called up an MNC and said, listen, please arrange a special interview for this girl. She got in. Her father was retired, her sister was working in a public sector bank. So this girl got a higher salary than her elder sister, who was non-disabled, mind you. And this really gives tremendous confidence to that kid. We are still learning our lessons in this program. It's just 1 year old. JP Morgan, who's our funder, told us that many have failed in this, but we said, give it to us, we will try. We've signed MOUs. Colleges are very keen. University of Bombay, University of Chennai, everyone has come on board. The problem is that in India, the more educated you are, the more difficult it is. These youth have their degree in hand. They're engineers, they are MBAs, but their technical knowledge is -0 because the faculty does not know how to train the disabled. So their aspirations are very high because they have the degree in hand. So they won't take any job. You know, they're clear, this is the job we want. So my team is still struggling with these, but we found some answers. Like what we are doing now is we are tying up with the MNCs and companies and then working backwards with their help to build the curriculum. So we have HSBC, in fact, our recent major breakthrough was in Bombay, where we did a company workshop with CII and DFID, and the head of one of the private sector banks was there. He was so inspired seeing everything that he said, okay, I'll take 50 interns who are blind. So that for us was a huge, huge breakthrough. And right now, my two colleagues, you can put your hands up, are working actually on this batch of the visual impaired in Bombay to get them into this private sector bank. But it's not easy. We hope we'll get there. This is one of the colleges of the disabled. What we're also doing is setting up this new concept called Smart Inclusion Center, which are experiential zones for companies. So when companies come, you know, we'll tell them, listen, if you can't see, what do? You wear specs. Likewise, these youth, they may not be able to speak, they may not be able to see. There's some technology which helps them to be productive and they can work with you. Long term, and every day I learn when I go to these schools, it's a government girls blind school. So what we are doing there is we want to improve learning outcomes through technology. So from class 6, we've introduced computers. We teach them English. It's a vernacular medium high school. I'm happy to tell you the government teachers who are least interested slowly are watching us and now coming and asking us whether we can teach them JAWS and NVDA, which we're very happy to do. Besides teaching them computers, we do fun things. And my whole team volunteers for this. For example, we teach them painting. We teach them, you can see the girls smelling. We were teaching them colors. Through different colors, we put in different spices. She's smelling, you know. Orange is cinnamon, something else is cloves, okay. So it's a lot of fun. And what these girls tell us at the end of this workshop is that for the first time, things which they were always told all their lives, you cannot do, now they can. They were told you can't paint, we're telling them paint. They're saying you can't do clay workshop, we're showing them they can. And this itself gives these girls so much confidence, I can't tell you. These are our girls. We have a lot of company volunteers coming in to do various workshops. In fact, I think very soon we're going to start a coding workshop for the girls to see whether we can teach them to be coders. The first batch has completely passed and we put them into an English medium 11th and 12th so that we can work on them through the graduation and then get them into jobs. The heart of our work, however, is in companies. There's a huge, huge difference between working with a non-disabled youth and a disabled youth. The biggest difference is the work you have to do in companies. So every time the company asked a question, how? Is it expensive? What do I do? We put in a service over there. So now we've developed a whole series of services and have become like a one-stop shop for companies pan-India. For example, this is Google Hyderabad, where we did a sensitization workshop for them. They invited us to do this. What we do is, these are like fun games. We make them experience disability, and then you realize for yourself, by Jove, yes, I'm not completely disabled, because if one sense gets taken away, your other senses help, you know. One of the statements I had made was that learning sign language is like Italian. So they immediately asked us for a sign language workshop. And today it's led to one of the largest hiring campaigns. Perhaps it's larger than Mountain View, I'm told. It's amazing. The chef told me he was hesitating to take youth with disabilities. He said today, the two youth with him who are speech and hearing impaired cook so well, their sense of color, he says, is so beautiful. They don't have a degree from the Taj or the Oberoi, but today he says he can take leave because both of them can manage it. In the dance school, our speech and hearing impaired girls have enrolled, and the dance teacher tells me they dance to a tune so well which they cannot hear. A film producer had recently come to the Google campus, and all the Googlers were standing in a row to take his autograph. Suddenly he saw these girls signing and he said, do you hire youth with disabilities? They said, yes. He said, can I take a photograph with them? So for Google also, you see, it's an enhancement of their brand image. So it's a win-win for both sides. This is IKEA, Hyderabad's first. IKEA's come and it's in Hyderabad, so we have their disability contract. The other thing we do is constantly doing innovations to get our youth not to be hidden in the back, but to be customer interfacing. So we're constantly thinking, where are the jobs which are customer interfacing? We thought of the cashier. The cashier is there everywhere. The cashier is there in malls. The cashier is there in hospitals everywhere. So we said, why can't this cashier's job be done by a speech and hearing impaired? Now the retailers hesitated because it's a very crucial job. Accuracy is important. We persisted, Landmark agreed. So in Lifestyle Chennai, we piloted the first cashier in the mall. My team sat there, understood the work, put in workplace adaptations. After 3 months, the company ran a survey to see what do customers want. Do they want a speaking cashier or do they want a silent cashier? What do you think was the answer? 97% of the consumers said they wanted a silent cashier. Because there's no chit-chat, there's accuracy. And today, this very simple pilot of ours has resulted in unlocking the potential of over 75,000 jobs for the youth with disabilities. It doesn't matter we don't skill, but the position of cashier has been mainstreamed for a youth with disability. And that is our aim, not to do it ourselves, but to unlock the potential of the job. This is our partnership with Naturals. We said, okay, health and wellness is a huge growing, beauty and wellness is a huge growing segment. So why can't we have one parlor, an upmarket parlor, which is manned only by people with disabilities? So CK and we created this in an upmarket part of Chennai. All the girls you see in the picture looking so glamorous, they all from villages, remote villages, looking so chic and smart now. In fact, the hair cutter is a girl who's a burns victim, and there's a 2-day waiting list to cut the hair. The visually impaired, of course, do acupuncture and acupressure. I went for the inauguration myself, and I was really amazed at the buzz around me. Everyone seemed to say, oh, long last now, our manicure and pedicure will be done without chit-chat, in silence, you know? And I realized to myself that silence is golden in this noise pollution which is around us. So we use this now very successfully in companies to drive the advantage which our kids naturally have. This is a French company called Valeo. The CEO called me and he said, Meera, you know, your work is very good karma. Can you give me one receptionist? So I told Jay, listen, you just hang on. Let us do our processes. We put 20 speech and hearing impaired into the manufacturing plant. It worked so well. They were winning the productivity award every month. They didn't have any union problem. Accuracy was great. It spread to the Pune factory. When the first inclusion award was constituted in France among the 3,500 global plants, our work won the first inclusion award. Not just this, when the new chairman came, the only person he shook hands with was one of our alumni in Pune, and that's because I was told that he manages 3 operations simultaneously, which no one else can do. So that's our work. We encourage, especially in the manufacturing sector where you can measure, we encourage companies to measure it, and that helps. This has resulted, our work in value has resulted actually in opening up the entire auto industry segment for us. The Caterpillar team came from US to look at our work. We work with them. We work with the Japanese market. Amar Raja, the chairman, amazing person, a huge giver. He said, I'll sit for 5 minutes, Meera, in your workshop. He sat for 4 hours. And at the end of it, he asked us to look at all his 11 business divisions. And today, we're going to work as a serious partner to see how Amar Raja batteries can be inclusive. So yes, when we began our work, the speech and hearing impaired, used to work in an exploitative manner in the unorganized housekeeping industry. Today, we've really opened up the sector, and this is because our work, we know, helps the business. But what energizes our batteries and keeps us going is stories like Mekala. Mekala lost his leg due to an accident, and of course the company threw him out of jobs because he's from a village, he doesn't know how to fight for his rights. He had no insurance, he came to us. We retooled him and we put him into this gaming company called EA. When we actually called his mother, she cried on the phone because she had not heard of so many zeros in her salary. She's the wife of a marginal farmer. But the more interesting part of it is that 3 months back, there was this Telugu film which the actor Nagarjuna gave us to show our alumni, where he's a businessman on a wheelchair. So I met Meghla. So Meghla came up to me and he said, "Hello, madam, how are you? Now I have so much money." So I said, "Oh, good, you have so much money. What do you do with it?" So he said, "I send money back home, but I still have money. What I do is when I go back to my village, I buy slates, books, rubbers for all the kids who don't have." And he says, "Now I feel so happy because when I arrive on the bus in the village, all the kids come and, you know, they cheer me, they hold my legs." So this is Mekala. When he gives, he receives. Friends have been asking me again and again, especially when my husband was he was in Italy for a long time with UNESCO. So they couldn't understand what the hell I was doing in India, 24/7 working with youth with disabilities. It's hard to explain, but it's mothers like Indirama, the mother of Vinod. She was telling in one of the meetings to the minister, mothers, as they grow older, they worry about their child with disability. They worry because they know the siblings is going to throw this child out of the house. So she was telling the minister that bless Youth for Jobs, which has given us, now I can die in peace. And not just that, she said, none of my other sons have thought of giving anything back to me. This boy, Vinod, he sends part of his salary, and he's given me a modern phone where he can video chat and speak to me. So that's a child who also gives back always. And look at what I hear every day, see every day with my eyes. Kiran from Bihar. Father was a mill worker, thrown out of job, young, blind girl, always told to shut her mouth because what can she do? She did her 10th class with great difficulty doing embroidery. We put her in one of the large supermarkets over there. She called me once to say, "Madam, there's flood. No youth have come. I can manage the whole floor by myself. Now the manager is happy that I can do it." Today, she supports her family. She educates her brother for his engineering. And the whole social situation has turned upside down, which has given her an amazing voice. Gopal in Bombay, cerebral palsy, he speaks with a lisp. And his mother told us that he was confident that he could get a job. So he would pick up the phone, looking at the newspaper job positioning, but the minute the person on the other hand heard his strange voice, what would they do? Disconnect. He came to us and we put him in Tata Star Bazaar. And people who go there to Andheri's Tata Star Bazaar tell us that this boy, they actually go because he's always there at the entrance to greet them with a smile. Lulu on a wheelchair. She's so severely disabled that even my team struggled again and again to get her a job. 2 times we tried. And every day she would send me an SMS saying, "No job still, madam," even before I opened my eyes. But the team persisted. And today she has a job where she gets 3 lakhs per annum and doesn't have to worry about tomorrow. Apurva, He has low vision. He's virtually blind. We've got him a mid-manager's job in Axis Bank. The story is same in Guwahati, in Nagpur, in Warangal, in Trichy. Like Sunam, he came with his orange scooter. He said that he's been winning an extra amount of money because he's winning the productivity award. So with all that savings, he's bought a scooter and he came to show us that orange scooter. So the story is the same in every part of the country where we run our training centers. They come to us like chrysalises. They fly out like butterflies, so beautiful. We only give them the first window of opportunity. But don't forget, the ability is theirs. We only are facilitators to bring out that ability which is hidden, which the society cannot see. How do they spend their incomes? The first thing they do is most of their parents are in debt. So they return the high-cost debt. They put some money, especially if it's girls, they put money for their marriage. They buy assets. Some of them also take things like the largest color television, and why not? And they always educate a younger sibling. If they are not educated, they educate a younger sibling. Or after working for 2 years, then they go back and do a higher education because they realize they hit a block somewhere. And these same youth, we know, will get married. They will educate their kids. They will make sure their kids get better health. So I know with certainty that I leave behind a better India and a better tomorrow. I want all of you to think a minute about what His Holiness the Dalai Lama said. He said, be selfish, be generous. Be selfish, be generous, because when you give, you receive in abundance. Thank you.